Mic check.
Testing 1 2, testing 1 2. Sound check, are we okay? Nothing?
Folks, we're gonna begin in just a few minutes, so if you wouldn't mind, please come and find a seat, and we will try to get started right on time. Thank you.
Sound check 1 2, sound check 1 2, 3 4 5 6. I can count to 10. We're good? Okay.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming today. I know we've still got some folks coming in, and Senator Connolly is on his way. He's running a little bit behind with legislative matters, of course, so as soon as he gets here, we'll actually, here he is. Thank you, sir. My name is Lance Lamons. I am Senior Policy Advisor for the Coalition for Public Safety. I want to welcome you here today. Today's discussion is on justice reform efforts here in the state of Illinois. This is the first event in the Coalition for Public Safety's Fair Sentencing and Fair Chances National Campaign. I want to thank every one of you for coming today. Also, we are streaming live through our website and through YouTube as well. So welcome to those of you who are watching online. We're getting started right away. Thank you all for coming here, and thanks to our colleagues from the Illinois Policy Institute for hosting us here today and all of your hard work in putting this event together. Just a little bit about the coalition. The Coalition for Public Safety is the largest national effort working to make our criminal justice system smarter, fairer, and more cost-effective at the federal, state, and local levels. The coalition brings together the nation's most prominent conservative and progressive organizations, including the ACLU, Americans for Tax Reform, Center for American Progress, the Faith and Freedom Coalition, the Leadership Conference Education Fund, Freedom Works, the NAACP, and Right on Crime. We're seeking to pursue an aggressive criminal justice reform effort. These coalition partners, as many of you are aware, reach tens of millions of Americans who are also seeking common sense reforms and working to build a consensus around comprehensive efforts that are designed to address some of the most pressing needs facing the nation's criminal justice system. However, today we're going to focus on the state of Illinois, and much of today's panel discussion was generated through the Illinois Policy Institute's report, Making Illinois Smart on Crime, First Steps to Reducing Spending, Ease Offender Reentry, and Enhance Public Safety. This report, which was released just a couple of months ago, details how Illinois' criminal justice system could be more efficient and also cut back on its $1.4 billion state budget. Today we'll detail the reform efforts to make Illinois systems more effective by reducing jail and prison populations, cutting incarceration costs, reducing recidivism, and removing barriers for those re-entering society to lead productive lives. We're gonna hit on all of those topics here today, not just fair sentencing, but also fair chances for those individuals who are either have been released into the back into society or who are on the precipice of doing so. Before the panel discussion, though, we're very honored today to have with us and hear special remarks from Laurie Garducci, who is Director of Justice Reform for the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, obviously here in Chicago and very familiar to everyone in this room and also those watching online. Just a little bit about Laurie before I bring her up here for her remarks. Laurie joined the foundation in 1991 after serving as director of the National Forum on the Future of Children and Families, a joint project with the National Research Council and the Institute of Medicine. From 1984 to 1987, Laurie was the director of governmental and professional liaison for the American Educational Research Association in Washington, D.C. This position followed Laurie served as a Congressional Science Fellow at the United States Senate. From 1980 to 1985, she held a faculty position as an assistant professor at Pennsylvania State University. Laurie previously served on the boards of the American Psychiatric Association Foundation, Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders in Philanthropy, Grant Makers for Children, Youth, and Families, the Youth Transition Funders Group Juvenile Justice Working Group, and the Federal Center for Mental Health Services National Advisory Council under Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration. Laurie currently serves on the Federal Coordinating Council on Juvenile Justice Delinquency Prevention, which I know you just traveled to Washington this week for an event there. She received her bachelor's degree in psychology and holds a doctorate in educational psychology from the University of California, Los Angeles. Everyone, please welcome Laurie Garducci from the MacArthur Foundation.
It's always a little scary when you hear that litany because it reminds me of how old I am. In any event, good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us this morning for an important session and topic. I especially want to thank the Coalition for Public Safety and the Illinois Policy Institute for bringing us all together. And a special thanks to our panelists. While the composition of our panel this morning may strike many of you in the audience as unusual, for those of us who've been working in the criminal and juvenile justice fields, this is far from being the case. And it is in recognition of that fact that I want to take a moment this morning to talk about why having these unusual suspects gathered here this morning is so critically important. Now, on a personal note, the MacArthur Foundation has been working in the justice arena for practically its entire history. We first entered the field in looking at issues related to mental health in the law. We followed that closely with looking at the issues with respect to juvenile justice. And more recently, we focused attention on mass incarceration with the Safety and Justice Challenge, which we launched last February, with its focus on changing how America thinks about and uses jails. This follows a long train of issues and concerns the foundation has addressed based on a fundamental set of values and principles. We are concerned about human dignity, racial equity, social justice, the rule of law, and civil society. Of course, we have concerns about public safety and the quality of life. At each case when the foundation has entered into these different issues, it's generally been at a moment of crisis. When we first started looking at mental health in the law, there was concern about involuntary commitment, the quality of institutionalized care, the abrogation of the civil rights of people with serious mental illness, and their loss of liberty. When we looked at juvenile justice in the mid to late 90s, it was concern about the fact that kids were no longer recognized as kids, that there was a serious concern about the number of youth who were being transferred to the adult criminal court, even staying in the juvenile justice system, the sentences were more harsh and retributive, and there was a loss of this notion of rehabilitation and treatment. With our focus in mass incarceration, we continue our work in looking at jails, where there are over 12 million admissions annually. But what brings us here this morning is, while there's been this upward struggle and a long path to greater fairness, social justice, and racial justice, there has been progress. And with the momentum that we've seen gathering across the country, at least at the foundation, we're cautiously optimistic. Indeed, we might be at a precipice of major and substantial changes. We've seen sweeping changes in state laws. We've seen bipartisan support in Congress, maybe in one of the few areas where there seems to be bipartisan support and some activity and progress in legislation. We have unusual coalitions and alliances, as what's represented today by this panel and what brings us all here. I also want to note that the Pope's visit, who's here in the United States for his first visit to this country, also includes a visit to a jail in Philadelphia. And I commend all of you to read an op-ed commenting on the Pope's visit to this country and his attention drawn to jails, that's written by Newt Gingrich and Pat Nolan. So clearly we're at what I would consider, and I think all of us consider, a historical moment in thinking about justice reform in the United States. And we cannot squander this opportunity. This higher cause for reform means a greater responsibility to act. And the stakes are high. History has shown us that it's difficult to achieve change. And with this window of opportunity that we're presented, we must make the most of it. There's been this unprecedented and unrivaled growth in incarceration in the United States, a fourfold increase in a period of four decades. 25% of the world's population that is incarcerated in the United States, where we only total 5% of the world's populations. There's six times the number of young black men, four times the number of Hispanics compared to whites that are locked up in our prisons today. This punitive, retributive climate that we have experienced that brought us to this point reflects the political mechanisms and forces at work. And this has happened with great cost, financially, socially, politically, and personally. And so there are risks in championing reform. As we have witnessed, there is a potential for backlash, making reform all that more difficult and challenging, even when the forces are aligned. But it is critically important to all of us to think about, how do we want to respond to people in conflict with the law? What does it mean to have a fair and just and more humane system of justice in this country? And other systems are implicated. Now, here in Illinois, which you'll hear more about through our panelists, our prison population increased by over 300% since the 1970s. The cost in our financially strapped budget is at $1.4 million a year. The facilities themselves are overcrowded, and the projections are for continued growth unless radical changes and reforms are instituted. And it is in recognition of that fact that Governor Rauner created the Illinois State Commission on Criminal Justice and Sentencing Reform. Now, why are we optimistic in the face of all these challenges? Well, we've seen it happen in juvenile justice. As I noted earlier, MacArthur entered the field in the late 1990s when the growth in incarceration of young people had reached its peak. And now today, we see the incarceration for youth at its lowest rate in the last decade, where there's been a 60% decline in the number of young people who are locked up. We see more youth being diverted from the system. We see more of them held accountable in the community. We see more of them receiving rehabilitation and treatment. We see more of them getting mental health and substance abuse services. We see zealous advocates earlier on in the process, and we see less harm for kids of color. So yes, the scale is different, but who would have thought 15 years ago that there would be this turn in the tide where there is a wave of reform now in juvenile justice across the country? Now, certainly we were helped by Supreme Court decisions that have recognized how kids are different from adults. But I think there is a growing awareness across the country that we've been on the wrong course for too long. So that is why the work of the coalition, and as Lance mentioned to you, the unusual alliance of arts partners is so critically important at this time, because we are going to need broad bases of support, support from unusual quarters in different places, from evangelical Christians, libertarians, Tea Party members, conservative Democrats, moderate Democrats, from all stripes and political alliances, from people of goodwill, from people concerned about fiscal issues. We need all of these folks in play and helping us to push for reform in this country. And that's why I'm extremely gratified to see all of you here today, in the hope of together we can make the justice system more fair and just for all. So thank you very much.
Laurie, thank you very much for those remarks. Thank you for being here today. Thanks for your support and your leadership for justice reform efforts across the nation. You've been instrumental in this work for a while, and your work with the coalition is very much appreciated. Now we will get to our panel discussion today. Before I do, I want to thank again everybody. We've had a lot of arrivals recently. Thank you all for coming. The fact that we have a near capacity room on a Tuesday morning is fantastic. It shows the interest in the state and locally for these issues. So thank you so much for taking time out of your day to come join us here today. So now I'm going to introduce our panelists, starting to my left over here. Senator Conley, we thank you so much for taking time out of your schedule. I know there's a lot of things going on at the Capitol, and so we really appreciate you taking the time here. Senator Conley, actually my bios have left me. Sorry about that, Senator. I want to make sure that you get your proper introduction here today. Senator Michael Connolly is serving his second term in the Illinois Senate after serving 2 years in the Illinois House of Representatives. In the Senate, he serves on the Judiciary, Labor, License Activities and Pensions Committee, and Commerce and Economic Development Committees. He is minority spokesperson for the Senate Criminal Law Committee. In early 2015, as Laurie referenced, Governor Rauner appointed Connolly to his newly formed Illinois State Commission on Criminal Justice and Sentencing Reform, so therefore his importance in being here today, and we really thank him for his time. Senator Connolly is tasked with developing comprehensive strategies to reduce Illinois' prison population by 25% through 2025, which is a very aggressive goal, and with people like you on board, I think there's a great chance. Senator Connolly previously served as an assistant state's attorney here in Cook County and as a law clerk to Justice Alan Stouder of the Illinois Appellate Court. He has been in the private practice of law for over 20 years, and Senator Connolly is a graduate of Loyola University and the John Marshall Law School. And he is sporting his colors here today. Thank you again, sir, for being with us. To his left is Bryant Jackson Green, who's criminal justice policy analyst with the Illinois Policy Institute. And I have to share this story real briefly. When we were looking at launching the Fair Sentencing and Fair Chances National Tour, It just so happened it coincided with the releasing of the report that Bryant co-authored, which we'll talk about here today, the Making Illinois Smart on Crime that I referenced earlier. Previously, Bryant was a legal researcher and policy analyst with the Liberty Justice Center. He's all over television, so he's very photogenic, as you can tell. He's been on Fox News Channel with Greta. He's also writing and published in the Chicago Sun-Times and many other publications. Bryant, thanks for helping me put all this together, and thank you for being on the panel today. To Bryant's left is Benjamin. Should I call you Ben or Benjamin? Ben Riddell is the criminal justice policy attorney with the American Civil Liberties Union here in Illinois. As I referenced earlier, ACLU is one of the 8 partner organizations with the Coalition for Public Safety, and we definitely want to work as closely as possible with our partners at the state level, and Ben's participation here today is a great example of how our coalition comes together. Ben is originally from Peoria, Illinois. He joined the ACLU in April of this year. He had more than 7 years in office in the Illinois House as minority leader, I gave you a title without, oh, you're right, deputy legal counsel to the minority leader. Sorry about that. I will apologize to the representative later. The position of deputy legal counsel and staff to the Judiciary and Criminal Law Committees. Prior to his work in the General Assembly, Ben practiced law here in Chicago. To Ben's left is Jennifer Vollen-Katz. She is executive director of the John Howard Association of Illinois. Jennifer is an attorney and a previous director of the John Howard Association's Juvenile Justice Project. She earned her bachelor's degree from St. Lawrence University, her law degree from Georgetown University Law Center, and her master's degree in criminal justice policy from the London School of Economics. Prior to joining the Howard Association, Jennifer was a lecturer in law and clinical supervisor for the Federal Criminal Justice Project at the University of Chicago School's Mandel Legal Aid Clinic. Jennifer was also a staff attorney with the Federal Defender Program of Northern Illinois, representing indigent clients in criminal cases in the Northern District of Illinois. I thank all 4 of you for being here today, and I promise we will get straight into the discussion now. Senator Connelly, I'm going to start and direct this question to you. Earlier this year, as I mentioned, you were named the State Commission on Criminal Justice and Sentencing Reform. You also serve as Senate Co-Chair of the Special Committee on Restorative Justice. So my question to you, sir, is what are some of the solutions to reduce the number of inmates in the Illinois system, and how should corrections officials work to better rehabilitate prisoners to help them learn not to reoffend upon their release?
Where it was asked to build 2 prisons. this piece, he said, I'm not going to do it, figure out a different way. So it is a different time. How do we get to 25%? I don't have the actual answer right here. But I am proud to say that I represent DuPage County, and I think DuPage County for all, its reputation, and has a reputation for law and order with our state's attorney's office. We have diversion programs, we have drug treatment programs that are, I think, the model for the rest of the state. In fact, last night I was at a Republican function, and Bob Woodland was our speaker, and he talked about this very subject, which is there are people that are using drugs. They're not criminals, they're addicts, and they need help. So we have the subsequent drug treatment program, diversion program, DuPage County, which I'm very proud of. We have mental health courts, which I was chief co-sponsor of the bill that allowed the authorities to do that. And the Cook County State's Attorney. I know the GDs who want to be GDs the rest of their life, and then there are kids who are caught up in a bad situation and they want to change their life. There's a lot to this issue. Probation has a big part of it. The prosecutors, of course, have a big part of it. There is no one specific answer I have, but if I give you in a minute, what do I think we have to do is we have to have these alternative treatment courts, these all diversion programs statewide, much like we have.
Thank you, sir, and that's a great segue into further questions that I'll get to for the rest of the panel shortly. One sort of 30,000-foot level view that I would like to ask our other three panelists in order. Bryant, starting with you, why did the Illinois Policy Institute, who has numerous policy issues that you work on, why did your organization choose to include justice reform as part of your overall policy efforts?
So Illinois Policy started. Basically, I think Illinois State Level Think Tank that will focus on researching and advocating for free markets, individual liberty, economic opportunity, and advancement for Illinois citizens. And if these are your goals, you really can't reach them without looking at the justice system. About 1 in every 100 people in the United States are in prison. At least 70 million people in the country have some kind of criminal record. So, it's really not just what you hear about when you're right. These are our sisters, parents, children who certainly made a mistake, but when they get out of prison and come to reenter society, these people have greater influence in front of them than the employment, watch that and achieving their dream. So when we set out that simply advocating this goal, other areas were focusing on tax policy, pension, stuff, and growth. This is for many people in our community the single largest issue. So it really just became an obligation for us to be involved in it. It's actually inevitable. Illinois started pressing for this year with the commission to reduce population by 25%. But it's long overdue. We spent decades building up massive pressure in the United States, both at the federal level and throughout the states. And it probably takes some time to get things back on track. Now is not the time to start on this. Now is not the time to everyone can cross and reach across the aisle to find solutions to help people get their lives back on track.
Thank you, Ben. I've sort of prefaced my question to your national counterpart, Jesslyn, in D.C. on Thursday, but can you sort of explain the Illinois ACLU's work in criminal justice reform over the years and how you came into this?
Data collection on stop and frisk practices. isn't giving us good public safety outcomes. It costs too much money, and it's having a terrible human cost. But the reason why we're at this point of consensus is because the system is broken at almost every state, from policing on the street to the what happens in bond court, whether people need to pay a cash bond or can afford to pay one. Overly long sentences, horrific conditions inside institutions, lack of capacity to give mental health treatment, substance abuse treatment. These are acute problems, and we need to get the workplace solved. Thank you.
Thank you. Jennifer, I pose the same question to you. What are your current efforts, and how did you come to come work in this?
Well, I think one of the things that makes the John Hall Association unique is that this is our issue, and it has been around for 14 years. This is what we started out doing, what we have been doing for a long time. Those of you who may not be familiar with our work here, Illinois is only independent, nonpartisan prison monitors. We fight for a fair, effective, humane criminal justice system, and we do this. We like to say that we are the people, other than those people who live and work in our Illinois prisons, adult and juvenile, we're the people there most frequently. And so we bring a unique perspective to these issues because we understand that not only do we need to change things in the front end and the back end of the system, we need to look inside our system to see how we're treating inmates, what we're giving them or not giving them, so that we understand how that influences and impacts the rest of the discussion. What I would say, because I don't think the John Hall Association takes a 30,000 foot view, we're right there inside the prisons looking at the system kind of head on. And I agree with all of the panelists, fellow panelists, if they are before me, but now I'm not before panelists. I think that if the governor's commission continues to draft reports and take testimony and do the work they need to do to give us concrete answers as to how to move forward to reduce mass incarceration, in the state of Illinois, produce better outcomes in terms of reducing our rate of recidivism, we need to not only decriminalize a lot of behavior that simply doesn't merit the kind of punishment we're giving it, we need to think about how we bond people out or not, as Ben points out, because we know that if they don't get bonded initially, the chances of ending up not only sitting in jail, but in prison, being convicted and then sentenced to a prison sentence, much greater. We need to also be honest about prosecutorial discretion. So much of whether or not somebody ends up being convicted has to do with what they're charged. So if you want to reduce people being convicted and sentenced to prison, we need to think about the front end, what is their behavior, how much power does a prosecutor have to drive this case forward. I think we need to also look at our sentencing laws, because what we know is for many people we send part of the problem, but how long they stay in prison is another big piece of the problem. I think we need to look at the back end and how that influences the front end. Until we are honest about what people need on parole, until parole can be a meaningful experience and provide financial support in the way that people in the society need it to be, it's more punitive and surveillance oriented as it stands, which makes it more likely that someone will violate, and so they will then return to prison based on that violation. And then I would say that once we looked at the front end and the back end and started to move on some of these very important changes, we need to look inside our prisons. I'm being generous to the Illinois Department of Corrections. I have looked at today's count, and I can say we're 47,000 inmates. Over the last month or so, we've been somewhere between 47,000 and 48,000 in a system designed to hold just over 47,000. Not only can you not program everybody, people in them who are crowded, you can't treat them humanely. Conditions deteriorate. Treatment deteriorates. Human beings deteriorate. If we want people to be able to re-enter society successfully, we have to give them the tools to do that. We cannot begin to do that unless our prisons provide the kind of treatment, training, and education that people need to lead lives that are successful.
Thank you, Jennifer. And Ben, I'm going to start with you on this question and work our way down the line. The Coalition's Fair Sentencing and Fair Chances campaign, which hopefully everyone in this room is familiar with. If not, we have information to help lay that out a little bit better. But the campaign lays out a clear baseline for bipartisan reform, both at the federal and the state level. And those reforms are built around two main pillars. Number one is that punishments should fit the crimes committed. And two, how do we address, we address the lifelong consequences of a criminal record. So my question to you is, how do you think that policymakers who are currently looking at the system as a whole and looking specifically into those issues, how best can they address those two issues in the current system?
Well, I think we need real sentencing reform for one thing. As Jenny mentioned, there's so much discretion working to improve their lives. Of course, we need the
Thank you, Ben. Brian, I'm gonna preface that same question to you with this, that your report that you have authored, the Illinois Policy Institute released recently, you have a clear set of recommendations to elected officials on how to address these things. Those issues do coincide directly with the pillars of the Fair Citizens and Fair Chances campaign. So my question is, of the reform efforts that you have seen in Springfield and throughout in other areas of the state, and that you're hearing as the chatter picks up around the governor's position, are you hearing things that you think can be addressed, and do you think they address those two issues that the governor report?
Yes, I think that commission has discussed a lot of issues, certainly diversion programs. That every time the governor has something like that. Both asking just two questions. On one hand, certainly 71 in prison right now really belong there. And we talked about that a lot in terms of code offenses and non-offenses. Is there some other appropriate diversion that we can put them through? But really, something like drug addiction that didn't need to be cut off, or simply not relevant. The anonymous too, of course, suffered as well. And considering that 97% of everyone in our prison system will get out eventually, we need to make sure that everyone's getting the appropriate treatment they need, be it drug or mental health treatment. They'll be well prepared for reentry. Right now, our recidivism rate, so the rate of people who return to prison after 3 years, is 45%. So that's astonishing that almost half the people in prison will end up back there in a few years. So I think that the reforms I've heard discussed, certainly for treatment programs, certainly to keep people out of prison, but also to keep people while they're in prison, are very important. The other motivating factors are for Illinois policy and other groups is to get a measure of fiscal control over prison costs. Right now we spend $1.4 billion on Illinois prison system. And certainly while a lot of savings that can be made before should be put into treatment programs, it can also come back to taxpayers. There's an image in our report where we sort of break down how long much of Illinois spends on a prison system compared to other states in the Midwest. Nearly $38,000 in account, not just the cost of certainly feeding the prison population, but for staffers, employment, pension costs certainly are very big in account of that, and capital costs and maintenance costs for facilities. So really, any way you look at it, I think that there's really a lot of need for the commission to focus on it. And we're going to talk about it. And I think what everyone else has said requires looking certainly at sentencing and reducing the length of sentences, but also what happens to people when they get out of prison. If you block ban someone from finding an occupation, bring them to meet another license to be a barber, for instance, once you're in prison, even though I can see I can have training programs to teach people to be a barber, which is just absurd, if they can't find a job, well, of course, crime becomes more appealing. When you consider the fact that 62% of Illinois prisoners have at least one child, if you're given the option between finding legal work to support yourself and your family and illegal means to support yourself and your family, of course, you're going to choose to support your family however you can. So if you make it hard for people to find work, if you keep them out of professions, if we don't provide so many job trainings, opportunities for people to earn a living, then we shouldn't be surprised if something happens. So that's the other thing I think that we really need to have to build focusing on reform to help people start to find work and get their lives right.
Senator, back to you again. And you are a leader in this area. You are working every day on these issues. Are the reform efforts that you're hearing about, do they address to making sure that the punishment does fit the crime? And also, are there plans to address the consequences of a criminal record that we've heard these panelists lay out here?
What Ben and Ryan said, all of that is being addressed by the commission. Your earlier question had to do with policymakers. I want to temper expectations because within the word policy is politics. So there's that. But I'll say this past session, as Ben knows, Ben was our judiciary lead guy before he became leader of the House. I've never lived that down either, but everything's incremental better. So this past year, for example, Commissioner John Fritchie, one of my old colleagues on the Cook County Board, called me up and said, "Hey, I need you and Sandbag, let's go have lunch." So we had lunch. And he said, "Do you know that he went to Cook County Jail and just kind of asked people, what's going on here? Why are you here? What's happening?" And a number of people said, "Look, I bought it out, but I gotta get 10% of that to ops, or to the clerk of the circuit court." So we did a bill this year to reduce just the jail population. We took that money back and gave it to the individual, took it from the court. Dorothy Brown's office wasn't happy about it, but it's a small incremental step. I did a bill this year, a good time, 30 days, 60 days, a good time if you get your GED. And I remember presenting it on the Senate floor, and a number of people kind of on my side of the aisle looking at me like, "What in the world are you bringing these bills for?" And I said, "It's because it's the right thing to do, and we need to incentivize people and give them, while they're incarcerated, here's my way out. Here's my next 40 years. I wrote down here earlier outcomes. I mean, I was trained by the Jesuits, but I didn't learn this because the Jesuit Pope is here. I did this for my parents to pay for me to come here. But to me, outcomes is what I'm looking at as the policymaker. The outcome is, I don't want to hear about 45% recidivism. I want to hear about 5% recidivism. I spent a day, policymakers should spend a day like I did at City over on the west side, talking to people there. I mean, that is the transition from prison back to the community. And I think it was UPS, FedEx. There were a number of large corporations that had programs that gave these people a great long-term view. This is my future. It's a steady job. It's a good job. And I can feed my family and move on with life. We need to have more of that as well. We talked about that actually in this very building when we had our commission meeting. It's how you incentivize the business community. And finally, I'll leave you with an anecdote. I'm a civilian probation officer, and I talked to him. You think I'm conservative, you ought to meet him. But he said, "I've got a guy who's 24, and he's got a felony from back, I don't know, 2 or 3 years back. Mom was on drugs, never met his dad, and he had 2 siblings to feed. He now has a job where he gets up at 4 in the morning, takes 3 buses, and gets paid like $10 an hour or something." My brother said, "Why aren't you, you should be making more money. You're doing all this work." He said, "Mr. Conley, I can't. I got a felony. I have to disclose it. I'm not going to get that job." So there are, we need to identify those individuals. And I know there were some bills this year that talked about a certain number of years of good behavior. We need to get them so that they're not just employable, but they have a long-term future in a profession so they can move on and put the past behind them.
Thank you. And Jennifer, I'm gonna question along those same lines. All four of you have spoken very eloquently about giving ex-offenders a chance once they're released. And we know one of the huge triggers for the overpopulated prisons is the recidivism rate. And part of the coalition's campaign is around fair chances. And so I'd like for you to address again in this question. How do we provide both publicly and private business, provide more and better opportunities for employment and housing for those who've been released so that we can bring that recidivism rate back down?
My hope is that we can get consensus on some of the bigger issues. that, as Ben points out, we don't only look at the low-level nonviolent offenders and figure out how we can make change, but that we can be honest about the harder cases of violent offenders who are sentenced to long periods of time, even though we know they age out of crime. If we're going to hold them for 20 years, we'll make it be safe, productive citizens. So I think we need to be thoughtful about being bold and taking action and not falling back on any of the pieces that come easy. And part of that, and I am hugely impressed by the Governor's Commission, and I have the privilege of knowing and working with many of the members of the Commission, and I hold their work in high regard. But I also think that those of us who are testifying in front of the Commission and reviewing their work and reading their reports need to stand up and be voices that say, this is great, be bold, make big change. And one of the things we need to think about as we say that and do that is the fact that right now, aside from the current budget crisis, there are so many places where we are losing ground and losing support that are essential to our ability to decarcerate in the state of Illinois. If we don't build community capacity for mental health treatment, substance abuse addiction, education, job training, we cannot get people out of prison and have them not recidivate. So we need to be thoughtful about how all of this comes together and impacts mass incarceration as well as our society in a bigger picture way. Now, in terms of what we can do to give people better opportunity, increase chances of success upon reentry so that we reduce our rate of recidivism, each of my fellow panelists have pointed out important ways in which we can do that. And certainly places like the Adult Transition Center run by the Safer Foundation is a huge step in the right direction. And I would say that's where we need to start. We have so few adult transition centers and halfway houses left in Illinois. They do fantastic work. I've been lucky enough to be at those adult transition centers. I've spent time at Fox Valley where the women go. Their rates of success are better because they get the support they need. They get help to do everything from the very basics. Get a state identification card, which for those of you who may not have done recently, trying to do that if you're not in possession of your social security number and your birth certificate, let alone a card, get you to the DMV. There are so many barriers to even the most basic and essential steps to productive citizenry. We need to think about those things. We need to help people ensure that they get state IDs that they need. We need to provide fair assistance so that they can get to treatment, so that they can get to job interviews. We need to think down on the ground, very hands-on, very step-by-step. What do people need to be successful? So if we start by releasing them, not from, say, solitary confinement out to the streets, but from a general population situation where they've had programming, to a halfway house where there's support available, that's a great first step. Then think about how do we help them get whatever education or job skills they need to put together a resume. Let's take the next step and figure out where they can interview. Let's develop relationships with outside employers so that they are open to interviewing people who've left prison and being a bit more open-minded about the skills and the value they can bring to industry. Along those lines, there are so many ways in which we can offer concrete support to our reentering population. So we need to think about things like parenting classes. As Brian points out, a huge percentage of the population are parents. What can we do to support those families? What can we do to ensure that some of the problems of the past stay in the past and don't come into the future to reduce the likelihood of success for these individuals? So I think there is a lot we can do concretely to make these changes. And then the last thing I'll point out that goes back to one of the first things I pointed out is taking on the hard cases. So not only do we have to think differently about how we sentence even those among us who scare us, right? We have those people who enter our criminal justice system because they offend our sensibilities and those who frighten us. And we tend to put those who frighten us away for very long periods of time. We also need to think about letting them out earlier, but we also need to think about things like sex offender registries and what kind of opportunity they take away from people. I'm not suggesting that we do anything to make our communities less safe, but I'm suggesting that we look at the research and be honest about about what we really need to do to keep communities safe and reduce restrictions that make it impossible for people to re-enter successfully.
Thank you, Jay. Would anyone else like to address Fair Chances, Second Chances?
Very briefly. In the legislature, we've seen over the past few years, and I'm sure we'll continue to see measures having to do with expungement and sealing of criminal records, ban the box, that limits what employers can ask about. Those things are good, but I'm personally a bit pessimistic about the ability to keep information under wraps. We really need a change in attitudes by employers that we're not going to look at the fact that you have a criminal conviction and that's it. I can't hire you. We have to look deeper at the individual. And that's not a bill that we can introduce in Springfield. That's a societal change that we just have to make an attitude. And that's what it's really going to take to fully restore.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, if I could address Jennifer's comments to me. Kwame Raoul is one of my best friends down in Springfield, and this year we had two or three juvenile justice bills that were hopeful, and they may have been unanimous support of the Senate as well. But I bring this anecdote. It was a sex offender bill we have every year, and it was in the criminal law committee. And Kwame, apologize that he's not here to defend himself, but he basically lambasted the sex offender laws and said this is, it's over the top, it's this, it's that. And I vote yes. You get the point. There is a political part of this discussion. When Kwame Raoul is voting yes on a sex offender bill that he even put on the record is right. It tells you where we are. It's just a reality of this whole scenario. So to the extent you get incremental change, please don't poo-poo it, because for those of us who push these bills and sponsor them and get support, particularly from my side of the aisle, sometimes incremental over 5 years
Yeah, I'm gonna sort of change topics real quick, and Brian, I'm gonna start with you. Over the past year, Illinois spent $1.4 billion on corrections. That's up over $184 million just since 2007. How do you recommend, and what has your research shown are the best ways to reduce spending on jails and prisons?
Well, a lot of that can be really just driven by certainly growth in the prison population. So to the extent that we're able to start reducing the population, spending will of course come down. A lot of spending is not even just spending on the people who are there, but the costs associated, certainly paying for corrections officers, our facilities payments. And the fact is that if you have 48,000 people in the system that designed to hold only 32,000 people, and costs will just sort of inevitably explode. One can have kind of capacity. Certainly given Illinois' financial situation, any proposing to build more prisons is just simply there's $111 million deficit. But in this year, they're still ongoing for next year, and so everyone knows that. So there's really only one way to start that. Really getting costs under control, and I think that's really going to come from population reductions, and then certainly along with that, cutting back on things like staffing, and then building capacity to help these recidivists. If people are coming back to prison, almost half of everyone in prison coming back within 3 years, this sort of cycle, not only costs our prison system, it costs our courts, it costs our police, it costs more than just that $1.4 billion we talked about in our paper. So, certainly, not just taking in some of the victimization costs and then costs that offenders have to have on their own for lawsuits and fees and fines for parole. So, to the extent that we can sort of break the cycle of going into prison and back out, resting in jail, and just sort of repeating this every every couple of years, I get that really vicious thing. I can be caused now. And if that comes from, say, a drug problem that causes the underlying crimes, if we treat that, the root cause of the crime, it's much, much more cost effective. Things like the first program that we don't really avoid costing around a little over $4,000 per person compared to the tens of thousands of dollars it costs to have someone in prison for a year. So I think that's the issue.
Senator Connolly, as a veteran of budget discussions, can you discuss the best ways to decrease spending on jails and prisons for the bloated budget?
I agree with everyone.
Very nice.
No, I think too that how do we keep them from coming when, again, diversion programs, they're not perfect. But there's certainly ways to provide discretion for courts, prosecutors, and the like, so that we're not sending, you know, your possession cases. There's a difference between possession and possession with intent. But as far as money for building and developing all new jails in Illinois, if you attack the recidivism rate, we find ways to stop this at the county level. Those are, I think, two significant.
Ben, Jennifer, either of you like to comment on the budget costs?
Well, there are three, just to reduce it to a kind of simplistic description, there are three things that drive population and cost. That's admissions, people cycling in and out, those are your low-level drug offenders, property offenders, many of whom should go in to begin with, and so there's money to be saved there. DOC spends lots of time, lots of effort and money processing people in and out who are, in many cases, going to stay less than a year and not get any meaningful programming while they're there. So reduce admissions by not sending the people to prison who should never should have gone to prison in the first place. Reducing the length of stay, that's the second driver, and probably the biggest driver, by getting rid of the ridiculously long mandatory minimums, getting rid of the sentencing or rolling it back, as I said before. Many have suggested that post-sentence review, some kind of a system for people who are currently serving the extreme sentences that under this tough on crime regime several decades, to go before the prisoner review board or go before some body to say, look, I've served decades in prison, I'm rehabilitated, I can be safely released. There are all sorts of proposals out there about that. And the third cost driver and population driver is recidivism. More crime when they get out and they come back. And the way we need to reduce those costs is actually to invest upfront in treatment capacity, programming inside the correctional facilities, having meaningful reentry, meaningful parole, and also reducing the abysmal conditions of confinement that exist in so many of our prisons, because that makes people worse.
And I will reiterate what everyone else has said, and I agree with all that those are ways in which we can contain costs. I'll just add two other ideas that haven't been brought out yet. One is, what we know is community corrections is more effective at reducing recidivism, and it costs less than incarceration. And the second thing I'll mention is, one of the things about having a huge prison system and being overcrowded in terms of our inmate capacity, we suffer from great gross understaffing in the state of Illinois in our Department of Corrections. And so that not only leads to a deterioration of conditions and a lack of programming, it also impacts fiscally what happens to the agency and to the state, because we spend millions upon millions every year in staff overtime because we're not adequately staffed in our prisons.
Okay, thank you, Jennifer. For the sake of time, I'll call for all four panelists. And Jennifer, I'd like to start with you, since started with the Senator earlier. We've talked about the report from the Illinois Policy Institute. We've discussed Governor Rotter's commission. We've discussed a lot of reform efforts today. But speaking to the audience and those people who might see this in the media, how can Illinois look to reduce jail and prison populations, cut costs, and also ensure public safety? I know that sounds like a lot, but we think this is possible. The Fair Sentencing and Fair Chances campaign lays out the possibilities there. But final comments on how you think all of those goals can be achieved.
Yeah, I think we can certainly do all of that. And I won't go back and pull up all the specifics that all of us have spoken about, but change in attitude, which I see happening. As I like to say, it's criminal justice reforms, 15 minutes, let's use it, let's make sure we take this as far as we can. I think we do have the left and the right coming together, recognizing the importance of this issue and how it impacts society, the head of the game. We have a saying at the John Howard Association, we don't care if you come to the issue with your heart or your wallet, just come. Once you get there, it seems like we all draw a lot of the same conclusions, which is a great start in ensuring that change will happen. I'm excited about the work that this commission is doing, and I think that change happens both boldly and in more subtle ways as well. And at the John Howard Association, we certainly embrace that change in all forms. We look forward to working with people on this panel and with reformers throughout the state of Illinois to ensure that these changes take place.
I would just echo the call for boldness, and what we often see is that somebody comes with a great proposal, and by the time it works its way through the system, it's a pretty good proposal that's been watered down a lot. So we should not expect this to be any different. We should push this to the Governor's Commission to be as bold as it can in what it suggests, and it's going to have to be. Meet this 25% incarceration reduction to truly recommend policy changes that are going to achieve that goal is going to require this. But then we'll need the General Assembly and the Governor himself to follow through on those bold recommendations that we are so hopeful that the Commission will come out with, and to actually enact them into law and not water them down and not let political considerations and the sort of boogeymen of the past where somebody's going to get burned for being soft on crime, for doing something that is smart on crime. We need them all collectively move past that in order to actually achieve that strong recommendations that actually become law. And I'm very hopeful, very optimistic that we're at that moment. But we need to bring it across the finish line, and it's going to require a lot of work and a lot of tough decisions for policymakers that have been used to for the last several decades, only moving things in one direction, tougher sentences, tougher on crime. We've kind of put the brakes on that. Now we need to put the car in reverse, and or maybe a better metaphor is throw out this whole junker car that doesn't work and start anew with a new system that does make sense and makes our communities safe. Thank you.
Brian, how do we get there?
If anything, you can write this to me, white papers as you want, right? But at the end of the day, really make change or reform a real thing. I think we have to think about how this affects real individuals, real people. One of the things you say in Illinois policy all the time is that policy changes minds. So we can make all the recommendations we want, but just to stretch criminal justice reforms 15 minutes for as long as possible to keep attention on the issue. I think you have to just visit our jails, visit our prisons, meet people who are there, vision of the people who this actually affects. And not just the ones there, but their children, their family. Experience and get to know some of the struggles they go through and get a full sense of the expansion of the system. Because I think once you actually meet people who live this day to day, once you go beyond the white papers, the policy reports, and research, you can know that these are real people who certainly made big mistakes, but who deserve a second chance. People, real people who just want to get off the objective report for kids. If you talk to ex-offenders, they'll always tell you that the one thing, largest factor keeping them out of reoffending, keeping them out of jail and prison, is being able to find a job. When I went to school, I was working right now, and I didn't make a loan to support myself and pay for my education. That's what they can't do. They can't find housing in cases. They don't have the same opportunities that everyone else has because of one thing they may have done that works the other lives. So I think by personalizing the issue, humanizing it, and getting in touch with people who live this every day and have gone through the system, I think that we can help give criminal justice more than just, you know, 15 minutes. And take the hard, hard choices to get our prison population back under control and help people make a change.
Thank you, sir.
Great. Thank you, Lance, and thank you to the panelists for being here and everyone for your attention. I don't mean to throw cold water on this, but there's something that has to be addressed as well. There are things that are outside of the control of government. I can't solve family dysfunction. We just had a commission meeting near Marlins High School, and a number of slides were shown, or at least 78% to 80% of those that were incarcerated said in a survey that they were from a single family, single parent household, and there was family dysfunction. That, I think, finally going on, comes with education. We educated Naperville, every kid in public schools, $11,000 to spend per kid. $11,000. Chicago, $15,000 per child. Are you getting the outcome? I want school choice. I want to attack the root problem, which is education and the lack of a solid education that is provided by the Chicago public schools. I guess that's the Jesuit in me coming out. I could list all sorts of things. Discretion for judges. When I was a state's attorney, I'm not going to mention the judges, but there were time and time again where the judges could identify and the prosecutors could identify. Here's a person in front of us who made one mistake. We need to pull back because this person, he goes into the system. He's coming out a hardened criminal. And alternative course, I know there are going to be some Southern Illinois colleagues of ours who won't be happy about this, but we need to mandate these courts. They've shown success in the counties and in Cook County as well. And then finally, this is from my experience at Safer. The business community has to engage. The business community has to engage. We have workforce development in DuPage County. Often I go over to see them, their offices in the middle of my district. And they will show me books of jobs they can't fill. We don't have skilled workers for this. We don't have skilled workers for that. Well, maybe this is the bold type of thing you're talking about. We need to engage the business community and the workforce development boards to fill those jobs. Perhaps it's to provide the training while incarcerated and before they get to Safer, so that when they get to Safer, the job's waiting for them and they're on their way to a productive and much better life. So there's no one easy answer here, but we all have to be involved. And politically, it's a lot like Mexico to China. It really is. You have Republican governors all over the country that are at the forefront of this. And credit Governor Romer, I credit all those who are here. It will be difficult, but we really have to do it.
I would ask, I'm going to close with this. First of all, thank every one of you for attending today. We've gone a little bit over time, but I think everyone has been paying very close attention, and thanks to everyone who's been watching this today online. Before we adjourn, can we please give all four of our panelists a quick round of applause? It was a fantastic discussion. There were a lot of policy reform efforts that we touched on. We hope that moving forward, both nationally and in Illinois,
thank you again from the Park Foundation for coming today. Your leadership is very much welcome, and thank you for speaking to us today. And also, the Illinois Policy Institute, Judy and Natalie, who I don't know are still in the room, and Elizabeth Murphy from the Coalition for every one of those folks has worked extremely hard to put this together to get the panelists, get the discussion moving. Please visit IllinoisPolicy.org to find out more about the criminal justice programs, and you can find the Coalition for Public Safety at CoalitionForPublicSafety.org. We encourage you to go to our website and learn more about our organization. Thanks again for coming, and I'm sure the panelists will be available for any audience questions as we go off here.